Hello YouTubers, and today we're going to do another equipment review. It's going to be on the Unity UT81B scope meter. Now this is certainly a very entry-level meter and scope meter. It cost about roughly $180 on eBay. If you do go searching on eBay, you'll probably see some people pricing it for like the 140 yard mark, but then generally speaking, that bumps up to around 180 once you include shipping. So the guys are either kind of showing it as 180 with free shipping or around 135, 140, and then they've got to add on for shipping. I got this, and I'll show you in the link. I think it's called Shop Triple Eight or something. We'll see now when we have a look in the bag. They shipped it very quickly to South Africa. I must say, I was very impressed with the service. We'll have a look at what's in the bag and what have you, and I'll comment about the quality when we get to that in a minute. But in terms of entry-level scopes, it's at a very, very good price range. If you look at X-Tech or Owen or what have you, you're going to be paying around $250 to $400 for those kind of scope meters. I'd be keen to get your input if you have any other ideas. If you're looking at anything with a name brand like a Fluke in the scope meter range, now this isn't a scope meter, although it does have a scope, but you're looking at kind of 10 times the price. You're going to start paying about $1,300 to $1,700, $2,000 if you go in the Fluke range. So certainly for someone who wants something just very basic and entry level, this might be an interesting review. So we'll see how this turns out by the end of our little review session. Okay, so let's have a quick look what comes in the bag. So the first thing to point out is that the one thing I was a little surprised about, this bag didn't come in a box. It literally came with the brown kind of envelope wrapping around it. So I thought, ooh, okay, I hope it's all right, but everything was. The meter itself came and it had that kind of protective plastic on here, which was a bit of a mission to get off. And kind of when I opened it up and I saw it, I thought, oh, I hope it's not secondhand, but it certainly isn't. Okay, so what's in the box? You get a set of leads, which we'll have a closer look at just now. You get a product warranty card with a serial number and the presumably, obviously, the date of manufacture. You get a free pen. So this is basically the company, RadioShop888.com. So if you want to go and look them up on eBay, so you can go and find it, there you go, that's them. You do get the set of crocodile clips, which obviously attach to the leads. They are the plastic covering, it has to be said, they are very cheap quality. But I would still say better than nothing. It's nice still to have these attachments on your leads, but yeah, not very good quality. You get these little protector caps that come with the leads. The nibs over here are literally to cover up the probe points so that they kind of are not going to poke into anything. You get this adapter to allow you to plug in a probe, but you don't get an oscilloscope probe with it itself. That is an added accessory, which you have to purchase separately. Now, I obviously have scope probes with other oscilloscopes. That isn't an issue for me. And as I found and demonstrated in another video, which I'll show here today, is it's certainly usable without a scope probe. So, but that adapter did come with it. It comes with the USB connection, so you can connect to a PC and view on your PC the scope stuff and save what have you, which is great. The software, a wall wart to power it. It came with four AA batteries as well, which I've obviously put inside. It comes with this operating manual. And obviously it does have an English side to it. And this is obviously the UT81B, which is an 8 MHz real time with a real time sample rate of 40 mega samples per second. And it's a 4,000 count digital multimeter. So the English, it's better than most, but it is a translation. So just be wary of that. So that's what's in the bag. This is the meter itself. Here is the
connection for a 6-volt wall wart, which you can connect in there so you can power it, which is great because potentially if you have got it running for a long time with this kind of display, it might chew through batteries. We'll have a closer look at its consumption a little later on. The quality. Now, I've watched other reviews where they say this is like a really robust and good quality. I wouldn't go that far. I think it's reasonable quality. It's got this kind of rubberized feel with the casing around it. The selector switch certainly switches on very easily. It feels okay, but yeah, if it was really hammered, it may take some abuse. It does have this standing bell at the back, which can be quite tricky to get out, but it has to be said, fairly stable. So you can certainly power it on, switch it on, and select whatever you need to quite easily on the bench without it falling over. So I'd say, yeah, certainly reasonable for the price. Remember, it is a cheap meter, so it's reasonable for what it is. But the plastics and what have you are of perhaps the cheaper sort. Okay, so let's take a closer look at the test leads. They've got these kind of shrouded covers here with the added protection of the little kind of plastic insulation there, the bit that goes into the actual scope meter itself. On them it says they are 600 volt Cat 4 10 amp, and on the other side it says 1000 kV Cat 3. The actual leads wires themselves have got some spec on them, which is pleasing to see, and it says they're 18 AWG. So the wire itself, although it's not silicon, it certainly the wire quality feels good. The actual connectors themselves are plasticky. For the probes, the tips are reasonably sharp. They are quite sharp. They've obviously got the threading for the actual banana clips themselves. They are branded Unity on them. Again, plasticky, but these are better than the worst I've seen. Certainly, again, for the price point, I certainly wouldn't complain. I wouldn't expect to see a higher quality than this, but I'm pleased to see that the wire on them is at least fairly good. Okay, so the one thing I want to demonstrate, and I'll come down a little bit closer so we can have a closer look, is the quality of the display. This is the one thing I try to get an inclination or some idea of on the internet prior to buying this, and it's very difficult. Some people say it's very good. Again, I would query that. I'd say it's adequate, but certainly not very good. If we switch it on, we'll just see it fire up. There it is. It has got, what I'm going to do, I'm going to switch off the light so you can see the total backlight. It's got this set button over here, and you've got a backlight and contrast. So we go to the backlight, you see it's sitting on number 31. We can adjust that down. I'll adjust it down till it's kind of all basically off. So that's with the backlight off, and sorry, you'll have to excuse the reflection, and let me now take it up all the way, just to give you an idea. And I think, just looking at the camera, I think the camera actually makes it look better than it actually is. You really do need to be looking at this fairly straight on to get a good view. So we enter that, and let's look at the contrast. I say the reason I'm kind of paying attention on this is because it's something which you don't get a good feel or understanding from looking on the internet. So I'm just going through the settings there, and that kind of seems to be roughly the best. It's certainly viewable and you can see what's going on, but yeah, I'd call it adequate. Okay, and just quickly before we start connecting it all up, I'm just going to quickly show these pages, which you can pause if you want better detail on the specifications. So that's physical specifications, general specifications. Then we've got kind of the features, it's noted there, basic specifications of the multimeter, the basic specifications of the scope. The things to note here, which I will pick out probably later, is The time base goes to 5 seconds per division. Now, as I said, I enjoy scopes where I can really show low frequency waves, and I wish that was a little bit longer. If it was 10, it would be great. If it was even more than 10, I'd be really, really happy. But still, the 5 seconds still actually works. But there you go. So there are the specifications there. Here are the specs and accuracies for the different ranges. And as you can see, we're looking at a plus minus 0.8% plus 8 counts. So certainly not a brilliant accuracy, but then ultimately it is a kind of compromise multimeter scope. There we go. Right, let's get to it. Okay, so I've got my voltage standard pentareth with the 5 reference voltages ready to connect up so it can see how accurate the UT81B is. We switch it on, I've got the leads connected, I'm using its own crocodile clips. By default, you see it'll often go to the scope mode when you power it on. So we push this kind of yellow mode light over here, and there we go, it then gets into the multimeter mode. We should have a reading of 0.2499. This obviously doesn't have the same resolution, but still, it's not certainly not too far off here. Let's just have a look if we play around with the range to show millivolts, what we get to. If we go to the manual 4-volt range, you can see it's sitting at 0.25, which certainly is not far off. So let's take it to the next one. And there we should be reading 1.5000, or obviously this is just going to 3 decimal places at this point, and certainly no complaints there for what it's reading. Now we're on the 5 volt reference, and we're a smidgen out there, but still certainly within spec. There we should be at 7.75, and again, although we are 0.03 out, it's certainly well within spec. And at 9.95, again, we're at 9.99 here, 98, but still, it's within its quoted spec, so no complaints there. Okay, so now I'm using the digital multimeter check, and we've got the 1 milliamp reference set there. I've set, obviously changed the plugs to measure milliamps. I've got on the milliamp range, and as you can see, it's setting at 0.99 milliamp, which again is certainly within its spec. I'm going to change it to microamps just to see if that makes any difference at all. And just giving a little bit of time to settle, but again, certainly no complaints there. Okay, for the resistance check, we're now using the reference 1K resistor, which its measured value should be 999.3. So this is slightly out, but the quoted spec for this is 1% plus 5 counts, so it's still certainly within range for that. Okay, this is the 10K resistor, which should be 9.997. And again, although it's slightly out, again, it's certainly within its quoted spec. I have just out for interest, there is a relative button, so I did zero out any resistance in the leads beforehand. Okay, and this is the 100K resistor reference, which it should be showing at 99.9, and it is showing 99.8. So again, well within its quoted spec. Okay, so another quick test I'm going to do is I'm going to step up through the voltage range with my variable power supply. I've got my Brymon here as a reference because obviously you can't see my power supply. Now, this obviously has got a higher resolution, so you'll have to ignore the decimal place. But certainly, even starting off, it's doing very well at the starting point of the little bit of voltage that's coming out of my power supply. I'm going to switch it off up to just about that point over there, And again, if we ignore the last digit on the Brymon, which you're going to have to do as I step up through this, it's certainly fine there. Just remember that this is 0.8% plus 8 counts. This can be out through most of its DC range, as I recall. So as we go up, the one thing I want you to do, there's a couple of things to note here. The one thing is obviously the update speed of this, by my eye, it looks like it's updating twice per second. But again, it's not a high-end multimeter. It's a hybrid. It's a scope meter. So fair enough, there is a compromise there. The other thing to note is obviously the backlight is always on. Unless you manually go and turn down the backlight, it might have been nice to kind of have an on-off feature just to save some of the battery, but just something to note. So we'll take it up, and remember this is a 4,000 count, so it should retain the three decimal places up to about 4 volts. So let's just stop before we get to 4 volts and see where we are. At the moment, it's still tracking very well. Okay, so we go over and it's now dropped down to 2. Let's take it up a bit higher. Let it things settle, and there it's 5 counts out and not including any percentage difference, so it's certainly well within its spec. We'll take it to the kind of upper end of my power supply. And again, certainly within its spec. And even though there it is, 13 counts out with the 0.8% and the count rate, it's still within its quoted spec, so I certainly can't fault it there. Okay, so the other obvious common use of a multimeter is to do continuity. So we'll just switch it on. It comes to this mode over here. As it says up there, it's in its resistor mode. Now it's in the diode mode. And it quite clearly says at the top here that it's now in continuity mode. So let's just see how well that works. So as you can tell from the scratchiness, it's not latched. And I wouldn't have expected it to be. Okay, so it's certainly not going to win any prizes for its continuity tester. It's slow, the volume is quite low, there's no other indication to show that it's activated. Well, I suppose the display, but it's slow. So it's got a continuity tester, but it won't win any prizes for that. Okay, so to demonstrate the UT81B's kind of scope features, what I've got here, I've got just a simple Arduino project, Arduino Uno, basically fading an LED up and down using pulse width modulation. And we'll see how that's represented on the actual scope meter itself. Okay, so as we take a closer look at this, I'll just point out that I am using a set of scope leads, but this works as well just connecting up the actual supplied multimeter probes as well, just with a set of banana clips. And I'll demonstrate that a little later. So what I want to show you is what happens when you power this straight on, when we've got a signal coming into it. It powers on. There's a couple of things to show you. It goes to, it defaults to an auto mode, and you can see where it's highlighting the kind of range, voltage range that you've got selected, and the time base, 1 millisecond. And you can see that's jumping around, and sometimes you get a kind of funny signal coming through. So what I tend to do here is I go and change the time base manually. So if we go to time, and then when you've got a fixed time base, you tend to get rid of that confusion when it gets mixed up with the timing. So let's just play around with that. So I've got it manually set to 1 millisecond. If we want to go and change, if we set the range, we can obviously go and move the signal down. But as you can see, it's fairly quick and easy to get a signal displayed, and the functions here are fairly basic and easy. So if you're a novice to multimeters, to at least oscilloscopes, it's fairly straightforward in terms of messing around and getting changing the settings to get a signal displayed on the actual screen itself. So as you can see, if we play with the time base, you can clearly see on here, you get a representation of the pulse width changing, which is representing the kind of voltage or the amount of current and voltage which is being allowed to flow to the LED to fade it in and out. And I think for a novice who just wants to a graphical representation of that, that's where this Unity certainly comes into its own, because for its price range and its simplicity, it does the job. It's certainly not going to hit any stakes in all the adjustments and fancy knobs and what have you, but if you just want a graphic representation of what's going on a simple basic circuit, well then it does it. Okay, so obviously in the scope mode you've got some basic features. We can obviously move the wave, your signal down, so you can center it on your screen. You can obviously change the range, the volts per division. You can see up here as I'm changing, we've got 10 volts per division, so obviously we're not seeing much of the signal. I'll reduce that so we can see more. We're up to 1 volt per division. And if we go further, as you can see, so we get a nice zoom view of our signal, and we can obviously move that signal down. Now I'm going to go further, and I just want to show you something here. So in essence, we fairly zoomed in on the scale because we're 200 millivolts per division. And if we try and move the wave down, you can hear it's hitting a limit. Now also on a normal scope, you'd have a lot more play and be able to have a lot closer, and you'd be able to analyze the wave a lot closer. So that's where this has its limitations. It basically gives you a basic graphic representation of a signal coming in. But I say, I think for the basic needs of someone, that should be more than suffice. Okay, so now I'm just going to show you, I'm going to disconnect the actual scope lead and use the actual supplied probes to see if we can get the same result. Okay, and just to demonstrate, I've gone and plugged in the supplied multimeter probes over here. I've just used a pair of clips onto the signal source on the LED, and as you can see, you're still getting your signal. So even without an oscilloscope probe, you can certainly use the scope and pick up a signal. Okay, and this is to kind of show the other end of the scale, which is where I particularly find oscilloscopes useful, is that I've got a bank of capacitors, supercapacitors here, which I'm charging up. And in essence, I'm using the scope meter just to give me a graphical representation to show me how the voltage is slowly climbing across the capacitors. Now, you can see it's just about to go out of range, so I can obviously pull that down to get it back in. I can change the voltage range so that I can fit more on the screen. I've got my time base set to its maximum of 5 seconds, and that's where I said I wish it could be a little bit slower, because then I'd have more information in the display. But in essence, not many people, I suppose, use oscilloscopes for kind of really low frequency signals like this, or graphic representations. I do enjoy that, but still, you can actually get a good graphic representation of the charge and voltage level building in the supercapacitors as they are charging. And obviously if I had a circuit that was discharging, then you'd see a big dip as it came down. Okay, so let's just take a little bit of a closer look inside it and kind of accessing the batteries and what have you. Okay, so into the kind of battery part of it. And again, these were the supplied batteries, lovely golden power. I'm sure you could do better by putting some Duracells or good name brand batteries in here. Just to point out, it does actually have a metal receiver for the screw that goes into the battery door. So certainly no complaints there. Okay, so what I've done here, I've connected up my power supply as a 6-volt source for this. I've got this multimeter, the Fluke 87, connected so it can read the milliamp consumption. And there you go. It's certainly sucking a fair bit of juice, 125 milliamp. Let's just see if we can change what that changes to as we flick, first of all, through the different settings. Doesn't alter too much. Let's see what happens if we take that backlight down. Heavens. Okay, so the backlight is now off and it's still chewing 117 milliamp. So it's certainly going to potentially chew through batteries. Let's just change it to its multimeter mode, see if that makes any difference. Nah. Let's go turn the backlight up again. To its maximum setting. Yeah, so certainly as a standalone unit just on the batteries, it's going to chew through those, I'd say, fairly quickly. It does, the handy thing is it does obviously have the DC jack, so it can have, and they supply the DC wall wart to power it. So okay, so that certainly is a bit of a compromise.
Okay, so time to quickly summarize that quick review of this Unity UT81B. In terms of its build quality, it's adequate. It's certainly not very nasty, but certainly not top end by any means. The multimeter side of it works adequately. It's certainly within its quoted accuracy that it's claimed in the manual. I wouldn't buy it to use as a multimeter because the display, again, I'd call adequate, but I wouldn't, although the digits are fairly large on there, reading digits like that on a dot matrix kind of half backlit display wouldn't be my first choice, but it can still be used as a multimeter. As a little scope meter, however, I think it certainly does have a place because of its price range and its simplicity to use. It's not that complicated to start learning how to use this, to get a signal up on the screen and to get a graphic representation of a simple circuit that you might be working with. By no means is any industrial person or person doing electronic design going to use this. It is for the enthusiast, the hobbyist, who would like to have a look at a signal, let's say when he's building Arduino projects or what have you. And there, I think it actually scores because its form factor, just having it on a small table next to you while you're working on some electronic circuit, it works very well in that regard, because a normal oscilloscope, something like that back there, is going to consume a lot of space, is going to cost a fair bit more, and is a little more complicated to use, whereas this isn't. So I certainly think it has a place. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed that review. If you do have any comments or queries, then certainly do post them and I'll do my best to answer them. Thanks very much for watching, and again, if you do enjoy the video series, then do subscribe. And if you gain any value out of my videos, then please give them a thumbs up. Thanks very much for watching.